For me, one of the hero Japanese cars has always been the Toyota AE86. Unfortunately, these days, they are getting increasingly rare and also increasingly expensive. A standout at World Time Attack is Ben's AE86 that's been doing drift demonstrations, and we pinned him down for a bit to talk a little bit about the combination. Now, Ben, for a start, you've told me already, this was actually your first car. How do you luck into an AE86 as your first car to learn how to drive?
It was just something I always wanted. I don't even remember why I wanted it. I just knew that I needed an AE86. And they were affordable back then.
Let's talk about that. I mean, I was just looking at one back in New Zealand a few months ago, and we were looking in the 50,000 New Zealand dollar vicinity for something that was tidy but not amazing. Yeah. What did you pay for this thing?
I paid $3,000 for this car 12 or 13 years ago. It was completely standard.
I wish I had a time machine.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm about to travel through time. I bid you adieu.
All right, so let's talk about the development of it. It's obviously very far from standard, and I know that you've gone through a few engine combinations in it. The current one, which we'll get to, is Honda-based, and you've gone through a few Toyota-based ones before that. So, yeah, let's hear what it's had.
So originally it was 4AC, standard, very slow, not very exciting. Then I went to 20-valve silver top, and then silver top 7AG, and that was a bit underwhelming, and then that's when I went to the K-Series.
However, these cars are really light, and particularly with a fairly narrow tyre on them. Obviously, you're drifting this car. It's not always a case of more power is necessarily better.
Oh, definitely not. Corollas are known for their driving style. You need to be able to drive the car fast before you need the power. And I don't feel like I'm the best Corolla driver in the world, but I like having the power.
Okay, let's talk about the rest of the combination in terms of the rear end as well. One of the problems with the factory rear end in the AE86 is the top links are relatively short, so you've got a back seat. I see that you've rectified that. Can you talk to us about the problems with those short upper arms and how you've gone about correcting that?
Yeah, so with the short upper arm and the really long lower arm, as the diff goes up, it wraps the diff forward because they have a really short radius of their travel. I've gone and fabricated boxes for the upper control arm to run a lower so that they're the same length, top and bottom. It keeps the diff parallel as it goes up and down and stops the diff changing angle and the pinion changing your grip.
So that's the problem, is the pinion angle changes the grip.
Pinion angle changes really aggressively from factory, and the grip level changes as the arc of the suspension moves.
Obviously no room for a back seat, less of an issue, particularly now you've also got a half cage in it, and you run a fabrication shop, so obviously all of this pretty second nature to you?
Yeah, pretty easy. I actually sell those as a kit that people weld into their cars now.
So a pretty popular option for anyone with an AE85 or AE86?
Yeah, it's great for motorsport stuff. Probably not a street car modification, but good for handling.
Okay, let's get back to the front of the car. So you've got a K-Series in it at the moment. Now, I'm not here to judge. I've always been a bit of a fan of keeping the same engine as chassis, but obviously the K-Series does make a lot of sense. What was it that drove you towards going that direction rather than maybe a turbo 4A or 7A combination?
I feel like AE86s, K70s, they need to stay naturally aspirated. That's like the spirit of these cars, to me anyway. So I had to have an NA engine, but I wanted more power, and I just started looking at what was available, what I could use. And it was either a 3RZ, big capacity, four-cylinder, could make it fit, or the K24. And once I started looking into this engine and how well-developed they are from factory, it was just blew me away, and I just had to have one.
And I can't argue with your choice there. It's probably arguably the best four-cylinder naturally aspirated engine out of Japan, even in stock form. Not hard to extract good power out of them. Add the K24 bottom end, 2.4-litre capacity, even better. Can you talk us through the combination? What are the parts in there? How modified is that engine?
So originally when I did this engine swap, it was just a stock motor with the obviously rear-wheel drive setup, and that made more than enough power. But now we've got 13.7:1 compression ratio, pistons, rods, all the bells and whistles, Drag Cartel cams, running an E85 setup, so it's fairly highly strung now.
Is the E85, imagine there, probably a requirement with 13.7:1 compression? That's definitely getting up there?
Yeah, dedicated E85 now.
And with the cams, obviously there's this huge, huge range of options with cams. Obviously, the stock K20 runs a variable cam control plus Honda's VTEC mechanism. Are you retaining both the variable cam control and VTEC, or have you gone with a VTEC killer style cam?
I still have both. Being a drift car, like, I want to have some mid-range power still, being able to feather the throttle out of corners and stuff like that. So I've gone the biggest cams that I could run before you have to delete the VTEC, and it's great.
That cam control, variable cam control, is a great addition in order to get that wider power band. So what is the usable power band of the engine now?
I'd say, I've only just started driving this car again this weekend, but I'd say the good power band's from about 5,000 to 8,000 RPM.
It's a pretty wide power band though. In terms of engine management, what have you got going on there?
EMtron KV8 ECU, and the guys at Insight Motorsports did all the wiring.
Power?
Makes 260 horsepower, so 190 something kilowatt.
It's a pretty healthy natural aspirated engine. Again, the K series just showing just how strong it is. And in terms of the rest of the drivetrain, what's the gearbox you've got in it?
So the gearbox is from a Lexus IS200, the J160 six-speed, and I've done a custom bell housing on it to mount to the engine.
And in future modifications, anything else that needs to be done to this? What do you feel it's lacking? Anything else you want to change or try in it?
So the harmonic balancer has actually just died, so I want to get an ATI balancer for that, make sure that the belt stays on because it's just come off. I want to change my steering knuckles as well. I shortened the steering knuckles years ago and it's always felt a bit weird. It's got a bit of a dead feeling in the steering arc. I'd like to play around with that a bit more and get it steering a little bit nicer.
I'm guessing there's a huge range though of off-the-shelf parts for the likes of that and suspension for the A86. Is that something where you'd buy an off-the-shelf part, or given you're a fabricator, make your own?
There's a bit of a winning combo with Corollas. People just run the factory power steering knuckles. That's kind of like a baseline good setup. I want to go back to that and just feel it and see how it is. If it's not aggressive enough, then I'll shorten them more. Because these knuckles that I've made myself, I think they're way too short. It gives it a bit of bind on full lock, and I want to go back to a baseline.
Sometimes you have to test a range of parts before you actually find where the sweet spot is. And also, of course, everything there is a bit of personal preference as well.
Yeah.
Look, been great to get a bit of a tour of the car. It's definitely been a standout for me. It's one of my sort of Japanese hero cars, and it's been great to see it in action. So all the best for the rest of the weekend.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
That video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.